The diplomatic standoff over Belarus has escalated further, with the European Union announcing today it will impose targeted sanctions. Here's the European Commission President, Ursula von der Leyen.
We will sanction all those responsible for violence, repression, and falsification of the results of the election. The people of Belarus took peacefully to the streets, and the authorities answered with violence, and this cannot be accepted.
EU leaders held a virtual summit today to discuss Belarus. Here's the EU Council President, Charles Michel.
The European Union stands in solidarity with the people of Belarus, and we don't accept impunity. On August 9th, Belarus held elections. These elections were neither free nor fair and did not meet international standards. We don't recognize the results presented by the Belarus authorities. The people of Belarus deserve better.
It was Poland who called today's emergency summit. It wants President Lukashenko to commit to talks with the opposition. Here's Poland's Deputy Foreign Minister.
You cannot rule the country without the popular support. I truly believe that President Lukashenko, he understands it very well that, you know, you cannot rule without the popular support of your own people. So the dialogue is the best option for now.
Well, all of this follows the Belarus presidential election on August 9th, in which official results awarded 80% of the vote to the incumbent, Alexander Lukashenko. There have been widespread claims of vote rigging and 10 days of mass protest. Ahead of today's summit, Mr. Lukashenko told the EU to stay out of Belarusian affairs.
They're holding a meeting today of EU foreign ministers or leaders. I would simply advise them, before pointing fingers at us, to focus the agenda on, for example, the yellow vests of France, the terrible chaos in the United States, the protests in Germany and other countries against coronavirus restrictions. What I'm saying is that they have lots of problems of their own, so don't point at Belarus to deflect attention from the problems that exist in France, the United States, Germany and so on.
Mr. Lukashenko's main opponent, Svetlana Tikhanovskaya, ran for office after the arrest of her husband. Last week, she fled to neighbouring Lithuania, where she's organised a council for coordinating the transfer of power. Here's the message she sent the EU today.
Honourable leaders of Europe, I call on you to support the awakening of Belarus. I call on all countries to respect the principles of international law. I call to respect the sovereignty of Belarus and the choice of Belarusian people.
Meanwhile, on the ground, the situation has also escalated. Mr. Lukashenko has stepped up efforts to reassert his control. He's ordered the Interior Ministry to end unrest in the capital, Minsk. A state-owned fertilizer company has been threatened with the loss of subsidies, but here are many of its workers still protesting in Minsk today. Meanwhile, state television journalists who went on strike have lost their jobs. According to the state news agency, the president said there should be no more riots in Minsk. People are tired. People demand peace and quiet. Well, this is already having an impact in the city. Here's a tweet from a fellow at the Atlantic Council. He's been saying, bad news, riot police back on Minsk streets, some rallies and protests disrupted, people are being detained again, searchers, intimidation of workers. Belarus had 3 days of peace, but that allowed Lukashenko to regroup and strike back. We can expect further escalation. This all comes as a third person has died from wounds sustained during the protests. Here's a tweet from the Belarusian journalist Hanna Lyubakova. She says, Hienans Shutor, a 43-year-old protester, died in hospital. He received a gunshot wound on the 11th of August in Brest. Relatives couldn't find him for 2 days. He was shot in the head. The Interior Ministry confirmed that police used live bullets against protesters in Brest. In Moscow, meanwhile, the Kremlin has officially commented on the situation for the first time. A spokesperson said conditions should be created for dialogue, but claimed there was foreign influence in the country, saying We think that in the current situation, the main thing is there is no influence from outside. Sadly, we do see some attempts at that. It is happening. We think this interference is not acceptable. Livia Paggi is the head of political risk at GPW. That's a global risk analysis company. She says Russia has been taking a cautious approach.
They know that it could be very dangerous to intervene, that they could create another Ukraine. Economically, Russia does not have the ability right now to sustain a war in Belarus, nor is there the popular support to do so. And also, we have to keep in mind that these protests are not pro-Western or anti-Russia. So in some ways, it could be, you know, much more beneficial to Russia to be on the sidelines and have these dialogues with the opposition.
Well, I'm joined now by Maria Saduskaya Komlach, a journalist from Belarus. Maria, thank you for joining us here on Outside Source. What do you make of the European Union reaction, their actions?
Thank you, Philippa. This reaction was very much expected, but the form and the essence of it makes us raise eyebrows. Why so late? The police violence was happening all the last week in Belarus, and it was pretty clear that elections were not free and fair also last week. But the EU has waited for 10 days, presumably for the third part of its message, which is to confirm that it wants to engage, or it is ready to engage, into the dialogue about the transition of power. So the message the EU is sending is threefold. It supports the people and is solidarity with it, which is great, but it offers 53 million euro, out of which 50 million is to fight COVID-19 consequences. I'm not sure people are really going into the streets because they're sick of COVID-19 in Belarus, and only 3 million is to support civil society and victims of repressions. And then it wants to introduce targeted sanctions, but the targeted sanctions against the individuals in Belarus have been in place in various forms since 2004 and have never brought any change. And even the idea of OSCE-mediated dialogue has already been implied in the early 2000s and led to nothing. So I'm hoping that the EU has real arguments to persuade the Belarusian side that this time it can play a different role.
There do seem to be fewer protesters on the streets today. What do you think is happening there?
I think they're taking a break because the hope that the Sunday, August 19th march would demonstrate to the authorities that there are many Belarusians who support change. This hope maybe not fainted, but it's transformed into the realization that the authorities will not accept this as a voice of the people, and that they will continue to spread rumors and propaganda about these being just a couple of thousand of people who are not happy with their salaries or former criminals.